Patriarchy is a theory that says the differences between the sexes and their social roles are not the result of biology. Instead, they are socially constructed, and they have resulted in the pervasiveness of male domination in women's lives. This idea of male domination has led the Good Lads Initiative to claim that traditional ideas of masculinity need to be reimagined. But it has also led, according to Doris Lessing, the novelist and feminist icon, to an unthinking and automatic rubbishing of men, which is now so part of our culture that it is hardly even noticed. Despite this rubbishing of men, however, the Marvel movies show that, in popular culture, masculine archetypes such as Captain America, Thor, and Iron Man, described by the philosopher Edward Fraser as a patriotic soldier, the son of a heavenly father come to Earth, and a strutting capitalist alpha male, retain their appeal. People are watching surprisingly traditional masculine archetypes. Nobody wants to watch films about characters like this. And one of the best established findings of modern psychology is that greater gender equality in a society leads to greater gravitation towards traditional gender norms. In the literature on this topic, sex is the biological distinction between male and female, whereas gender is how the difference between male and female is shaped by culture. So, researchers have termed this result the patriarchy paradox, shaping men and women culturally to be more similar actually exaggerates their differences. It is the opposite of what the social constructivist theory predicted. But it isn't paradoxical if patriarchy is, rather than being merely socially constructed, partly based in biology. Contrary to the claim that patriarchy is about male domination of women, it also at least partly results from women's choices because it benefits them. Much of what follows might bruise the feelings of some people, so here, from the philosopher Stephen Hicks, is a reminder of the elements of the traditional arguments for freedom of speech. Reason is essential for knowing reality. It's a function of the individual. We need the freedom to think, to criticise and to debate. And this is also of value not just to ourselves, but to other members of our society as well. In a cross-cultural study of manhood, David Gilmore, professor of anthropology, concluded that three moral injunctions seem to come repeatedly into focus. One must impregnate women, protect dependents from danger, and provision kith and kin. None of these three roles, procreate, protect, provide, is exclusively masculine, but the protector role is the least shared, making it the core of masculinity. It is the least shared because it is the one most firmly rooted in anatomy and physiology. Even in lion prides, this is very clear. Although lionesses do 90% of the providing, the males are responsible for protecting the pride. They only help kill the largest, most dangerous prey that would otherwise cost the lives of too many lionesses. Accordingly, in all cultures, war has usually been men's work. It is Gilmore's universal protector role. In mythology, this is embodied by Thor, who, because of his physical strength, alone stood between Asgard and destruction. By contrast, women have very rarely fought, and no country has ever obliged women to fight.
The advanced weaponry of the modern age hasn't made much difference. When the Russian army went to war in Chechnya in 1994-95, its female officers, roughly 14% of the officer corps, simply refused to go. Knowing the outcry that would follow, the army did not force them to. Female Israeli soldiers, despite mandatory military service, do not join frontline combat infantry brigades. The equipment is often heavy, making it hard for women to carry around, and sometimes it goes wrong. Michael Fitzmaurice on the right there served for the US in Vietnam. A grenade hit the tank he was in with his fellow soldiers. He had to get two of them wounded out of the tank, and then another grenade broke his rifle. He killed an enemy soldier with his bare hands, took his rifle, and then managed to escape.
War has usually been men's work because men, as a result of natural sex differences that aren't socially constructed, are physically adapted to fighting. Recognizing that gender roles will be less fluid if sex differences are natural, some feminist theorists, such as Judith Butler, have argued that not only gender but sex itself is socially constructed, claiming that intersex people, or people with only an X chromosome or XXY chromosomes, show sex isn't binary or natural. The biologist Emma Hilton, however, has described the idea that sex is a social construct as false at every conceivable scale of resolution. Sex isn't defined by chromosomes. In all species, even those with different or no chromosomes, females produce large gametes, reproductive cells, and males produce small ones. There is no third, intermediate gamete size. Intersex people are not exceptions. And the philosopher David Byrne has pointed out that there would have been sexes in plants and animals, even if there were no human societies, and therefore nothing socially constructed at all.
Some philosophers pointed out that, logically, considerations that support transgenderism would also support, for example, trans-speciesism. But we all recognise that there are limits to what we can identify as. Species, for example, aren't social constructs. People who identify as lizards aren't actually lizards. Similarly, if you're biologically male but identify as female, Hilton says, you still have small gametes.
So, what natural sex differences are relevant to the protector role?
The shoulders of boys and girls are equally broad until adolescence. Then, at puberty, the shoulder cartilage cells respond to testosterone, the male sex hormone newly produced by the testes, by growing. Pubertal girls, by contrast, get wider hips when their hip cartilage cells respond to estrogen, the female sex hormone. The sudden acceleration of shoulder width in boys is associated with relative enlargement of the upper arm muscles. The result is that men have far greater upper body muscle mass and strength than women. Men also have 4% faster nerve transmission speed. A major Marine Corps study found that women are at a significant disadvantage in combat compared to men. Even untrained males outperformed trained females. The Amazonian warrior women are merely a myth for a reason. And the adaptations are not merely physical. Men are more violent by temperament. Richard Wrangham, professor of anthropology at Harvard, observes that the 5-million-year-long trail to our modern selves was lined along its full stretch by a male aggression that structured our ancestors' social lives and technology and minds. Some scientists have argued that early humans first stood up to fight, and that fighting shaped the evolution of the hand. But aren't some women strong, and don't some women also fight? Yes, but look at what Tamika Brents said after her skull was fractured by the transgender MMA fighter Fallon Fox. I am an abnormally strong woman in my own right, but I've never felt the strength I felt in a fight like that night. I don't think it's fair.
If it's not fair to put men in the ring with women for sports, it's not fair to pit men against women on the battlefield either. War has also usually been men's work because they can afford to treat their lives more cheaply. From a biological point of view, the female role is primary. A population can survive the loss of men more easily than that of women. In 2008, ecologists Rebecca Sear and Ruth Mace published a paper called Who Keeps Children Alive? Across 28 cultures, the answer was that mainly mothers do. A mother's death was more likely to lead to a child's death, especially among nursing infants. For the same reasons, physical strength, greater aggression, relative expendability, the protector role goes beyond warfare to include protection against the destructive forces of nature. In Charlotte Perkins Gilman's 1915 utopian novel Her Land, in which all the men are killed by a volcanic eruption and the women discover a miraculous procedure for stimulating virgin birth, wild beasts are conveniently absent. But a world without men would be awful for women. Mining, oil extraction, heavy and chemical industry, long-distance transportation, most forms of construction, many kinds of agriculture, such as forestry and the herding of large domestic animals, would all but cease. So would deep-sea fishing. Under such conditions, over 90% of the world's present-day population would die of starvation. The women that survive such a calamity would likely revert to a primitive life based on horticulture, dwelling in huts and suffering from a permanent shortage of animal protein. Judging by historical and prehistorical precedent, their life expectancy would be reduced to less than 40 years. Throughout history, women have always been spared the worst work. Only male slaves were conscripted to die in their thousands for the pyramids, the canals in the ancient Middle East, the Great Wall of China, and the Rhodes industrial-scale corn mills and Colosseum in Rome. Even in mythology, there is no female equivalent of Sisyphus. And men invented well over 90% of the inventions that have improved women's life expectancy and quality of life. Some common objections to this protector idea are the witch hunts, the coverture laws, the vote, and rape. Marianne Hester, for example, claims the witch hunts were about men trying to suppress female sexuality, patriarchal power at its most tyrannical. But most accusers were women. Mary enacted the Scottish witchcraft laws, and persecution reached its apex under Elizabeth, who reinstated all the penalties against witchcraft that Edward VI, 16 years earlier, had repealed, acting on the advice of his all-male entourage. Furthermore, the fewer women involved in the trials, the fairer the treatment witches were likely to receive. The coverture laws are claimed to show patriarchal oppression of women because they prevented women from owning property, but the married couple was regarded as one legal entity. The husband assumed responsibility for his wife's debts, including her premarital ones. He could even be imprisoned on her behalf, while she was immune to prosecution. Regarding the vote, women have always had it at the local level in both parish and manor, and only 4% of the male population had the vote in ancient Athens, which remained an historical high until mid-19th century England. Even as the year 1918 began, it was still the case that well under 50% of adult men had a usable national vote. Unlike women, all these men shouldered some form of taxation without representation, and they could also be conscripted to bear arms. Lastly, rape is not a unique claim for male oppression of women, because male-on-male rape in jails dwarfs male-on-female rape outside them.
Not only did the most common objections to the idea that women are protected fail, but numerous recent studies provide strong evidence for it. Carey Mullis, chemistry Nobel Prize laureate, said it doesn't take a lot of education to check things out. All it takes is access to resources and a feeling that people might be trying to put something over on you. So I did some truth sleuthing and managed to uncover the following. People prefer to spare the lives of females over the lives of males, which sounds like male expendability. They're also less willing to harm females than males and perceive male aggression as more unacceptable. This sounds like women are protected and privileged. Women are punished less than men for the same crime. That's odd in a patriarchy with oppressive laws. They're also more likely to be hired for STEM jobs than male applicants. And people want to support social action to correct female underrepresentation more than they do male underrepresentation.
In response to this evidence, which puts the claim that society is characterised by male oppression of women into reasonable doubt, a desperate, bizarre objection is that chivalry itself is oppressive, that Chief Justice M.C. Chagla somehow oppressed women by ruling it lawful under the Constitution of India to discriminate in favour of women against men, but not in favour of men against women. It is worth remembering here that the overwhelming majority of women don't describe themselves as feminists, as few as 8% in Germany. According to the Education Research Centre, one of the characteristics of indoctrination is a closed system, meaning immunity to criticism. All data must conform to the theory of patriarchal oppression. Women who don't feel oppressed have just been oppressed into believing they're free to keep them oppressed. To use Karl Popper's term, patriarchy is non-falsifiable. Suppose, as G.K. Chesterton put it, you have a theory that all ginger people are trying to kill you. When you ask them whether they are, they say they're not, but you're too clever for them. That's exactly what they would say. Your system is closed. There simply is sexism, patriarchal oppression, and toxic masculinity everywhere, even in the structure of skyscrapers. As Elizabeth Anscombe pointed out, however, corrupt minds cannot be reasoned with. The protector role is universal. What virtues does it require? Because he faces great risks and must therefore overcome fear, the protector requires courage. Beginning in infancy and across all different kinds of cultures, men are less prone to fear than women are. Women self-report greater fear of crime, public speaking, accidents, darkness, cancer, heights, and high-risk mutual funds. Lab studies back this up. Women have a stronger reflex reaction to fearful scenes, they startle more violently, their hearts race faster, and they sweat more. Although less prone to fear than women are, men are not, however, fearless. The average soldier on the battlefield regresses and acts passively under enemy fire. Commanding officers sometimes have to force men to fight at gunpoint. Phobos, or fear, was the god of the battlefield for the ancient Greeks. Worldwide, the various masculine rites of passage therefore aim at the development of courage, tempering and toughening the initiates. They differ, but they all test a boy's ability to handle pain and fear. Feminists such as Eleanor Leacock have said the Kung Bushmen of Botswana represent an ideal of sexual equality, offering them as a model for the West. But even the boys there have to kill an antelope to become men, showing they are providers rather than mere consumers of meat. They are also subjected to a severe form of hazing involving grueling tests of masculine stamina. The boys must man up. Tonight I have taken all that I was and strangled him, that pale lily-white lad. I have choked him with these my hands, these claws, catching him as he lay a-dreaming in his bed. Then, chuckling, I dragged out his foolish brains that were full of pretty love tales, hey-ho, the holly, and emptied them holus-bolus to the drains, those dreams of love, oh, what ruinous folly. He is dead, pale youth, and he shall not rise on the third day or any other day. Sloth like a snake-skin, there he lies, and he shall not trouble me again, for I. The Good Lads Initiative claims the phrase man up is meaningless. In procreating, providing, and protecting, however, men can fail in a way that women can't. In procreation, they can fail in a very visual and humiliating way by being impotent. On the island of Truk, women laugh at a man's sexual failure, telling him to take the breast like a baby. In providing, they can fail to kill the animal. Unlike roots and berries, traditionally gathered by women, large and dangerous animals fight back or run away. And in protecting, the urge to succumb to fear is almost overwhelming. The ground at the hot gates was slick with feces and urine. Men wet themselves in the boats on D-Day. Childbirth, it is true, demands great courage of women, but you can't lose childbirth by running away. Here we see in Hector's lines before he goes to face Achilles that it's a combination of biology and culture that goes to make up masculinity. I've learned it. It's something that is cultivated. This is his duty given his biological status as a man. His culture has shaped him to live up to the responsibilities that that entails. He has to overcome fear. We see the same idea in this clip from 300 when the soldiers talk about having to earn their shields, live up to the ideal.
This is where we hold them! This is where we fight! This is where they die! Earn these shields, boys! Remember this day, man, for it will be yours for all time. Spartans, lay down your weapons! Persians, come and get them!
Good Lads Initiative claims that the phrase man up is meaningless. I wonder what King Leonidas would have thought of that idea. Closely related to courage is honour, the concern to protect one's reputation and that of one's family and lineage, pointing to the need to establish and defend boundaries. Only male honour is inseparable from strength and courage. Calling a woman a wimp isn't really an insult. Anne Campbell, in her studies of aggression in female adolescents, found that physical fights were rare, but they usually began with girls calling each other sluts, slags, or whores. Season 3, episode 6 of Sex in the City is called Are We Sluts? This is because women's honour is tied to ancient standards of sexual propriety. These insults advertise a woman's propensity to be unfaithful and therefore make men less likely to consider her as a potential partner. Calling a man a slut would probably just provoke a confused look. Women mostly harm each other with words and behind the back rather than face to face, using gossip to alienate and defame. You can't prove chastity in a fight.
I said throw down, boy. You gonna do something or just stand there and bleed? No? I didn't think so.
Apart from fighting, sport and games are a public display of men's fitness to defend boundaries. Boys are around 50 times more likely than girls to engage in games involving direct head-to-head competition. Adult men are also more interested in competition, broadcasting who is stronger, fitter, and abler to the community at large. Men compete harder and perform better when women are watching. And women often instigate the competition, as among the Maasai of Ethiopia, where they start stick fighting contests among the young men and lavish their attention on the winners. Male athletes aren't motivated by dominating female athletes, though. The dominance contests, apparent between males of all species and between females of some species, are within, not across, sexes. Biologically speaking, the idea that men exert power over women is nonsense. Across species, females can exploit their power of sexual choice to get males to compete in ways that do things for them. In most species, females could refuse the dominant male if they chose, but they don't. An elephant, seal, cow will cry out in protest if a low-ranking male tries to mate with her, summoning all the males within earshot to come and fight over her. And human women prefer the smell of dominant males, more masculine male faces, and men behaving more dominantly when at peak fertility than at other times in their menstrual cycle. This is because ovulation makes women desire a strong protector. Pregnancy and childbirth make them vulnerable. And it is wishful thinking to believe that boundaries can be established and defended without violence and the values of strength, courage, and honour that accompany it. George Orwell expressed this hard truth. Those who abjure violence can only do so because others are committing violence on their behalf. You might think that a real man prizes showing vulnerability and talking about his feelings or wearing rainbow laces, but he can't do that if he's dead. In this clip from Goodfellas, this character's girlfriend has just been sexually assaulted by a neighbour, and here he is about to seek revenge on her behalf.
What do you want, fucko? You want something?
Huh? Oh, hey! Hey. What are you doing?
I swear, my fucking mother, if you touch her again, you're dead!
Don't shoot!
Hi, please. Are you all right? Are you all right?
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah. I know there are women like my best friends who would have gotten out of there the minute their boyfriend gave them a gun to hide. But I didn't. I gotta admit the truth, it turned me on.
Wasn't that violent? Wouldn't it be lovely if we could get rid of violence? Well, in attempting to vanquish violence and oppression from the earth, Marxists broke all records for mass slaughter, murdering over 100 million people. Male aggression is a biological fact that will be with us whether we like it or not. Some people think that nowadays we don't need violence because we have the law. But in fact, the law itself ultimately depends on the threat of violence.
Leave us.
No, you stay here. I'm in charge.
Do you feel in charge?
I've paid you a small fortune.
And this gives you power over me?
What is this?
Your money and infrastructure have been important. Till now.
When Bane's hand touches his shoulder after he says he's in charge, he realizes that he's not really in charge because he can't back that up. And without violence, laws ultimately are just words. Now, the traditional ideal of chivalry is the attempt to deal with the fact of biological aggression among men. The virtue of chivalry is the virtue of one who has internalized the ethos of the protector, courage, prowess in battle, mercy to the vanquished, courtesy towards women, gentleness towards children, and piety towards elders. Machismo, by contrast, is a defamation of chivalry for men who forget that their strength is to be put in the service of the weak. The feminists' horrified reaction to domestic violence acknowledges men's special duties towards women. It is far, far worse for a man to beat up a woman than it is for him to beat up a weaker man. What's interesting here is that the idea of toxic masculinity, to the extent that it's true, isn't new. It was already there in the concept of machismo versus chivalry. So what's true isn't new, and what's new isn't true. Anthropologists have never found a genuine matriarchy. As Wrangham explains, patriarchy is worldwide and history-wide, and its origins are detectable in the social lives of chimpanzees. It has its ultimate origins in male violence, but it doesn't come from man alone, and it has its sources in the evolutionary interests of both sexes. This study shows that these naughty women aren't conforming to what the theory of patriarchy demands of them. They still like guys with muscles and money. Remember those three injunctions that Gilmore pointed out were universal? Procreate, protect, provide. In this Mary Claire article as well, we have a lady who has a husband who's smart and funny and likes to explain why the Sherlock Holmes tales are more colonialist than patriarchal. She also likes the idea of a stay-at-home husband, but the reality of living it broke her marriage. She says she had neutralized him as a sexual being. I wanted to be overwhelmed by the sheer power of his masculinity in the bedroom, but I wasn't, because I felt like the man in our relationship. As Tony Montana said, first you got to make the money, then when you get the money, you get the power, then when you get the power, then you get the women. Patriarchy will remain worldwide and history-wide until women start getting men to compete over being weak, cowardly, impotent, and poor providers. So rather than oppressing them, the fact that women get men to compete over them gives them tremendous power. Shakespeare scholar Marilyn Simon, in her article Feminism's Dependency Trap, reminds women that men adore us, and almost all their efforts at work or at home or in a social setting are made to win our approval, if not our admiration. James Watson, for example, Nobel laureate and author of The Double Helix, said that almost everything I ever did, even as a scientist, was in the hope of meeting a pretty girl. As James Brown put it, it's a man's world, but it would mean nothing, nothing without a woman or a girl.
This is why chivalry is expected. Look at this woman's face after the man she was on a date with suggested that they split the bill.
Despite its universality, however, cries of smash the patriarchy continue, even though this ultimately amounts to saying smash human nature and biological reality. And what is the alternative offered anyway? Andrea Dworkin, pictured, has been described in The Guardian as recently as 2019 as the visionary feminist we need in our troubled times. This was her vision. Men and women are fictions, caricatures, cultural constructs. Unambiguous heterosexual behaviour is the worst betrayal of our common humanity. The destruction of the incest taboo is essential to the development of cooperative human community based on the free flow of natural androgynous eroticism. The incest taboo can be destroyed only by destroying the nuclear family as the primary institution of culture. As people develop fluid androgynous identity, they will also develop the forms of community appropriate to it. Children are fully capable of participating in community and have every right to live out their own erotic impulses. The distinctions between children and adults and the social institutions which enforce those distinctions would disappear as androgynous community develops. Attacking the nuclear family, then, she advocates incest and paedophilia. Not only are the sexes cultural constructs, but so is the distinction between children and adults. It is worth noting here that Simone de Beauvoir, author of The Second Sex and founder of modern feminism, signed a petition calling for paedophilia to be decriminalised. By contrast, the core of masculinity, the protector role, makes it the antithesis of paedophilia. This is why in prison, child abusers are the most despised offenders. Dworkin wants to destroy patriarchal power at its source, the family, and destroy the structure of culture as we know it. But the family offers numerous benefits, not only to men, but to women and children. Children who live with their own two married parents enjoy better physical and mental health, on average, than do children in other family forms. Married women live longer and enjoy better health and lower rates of injury and illness than unmarried women. They are substantially less likely to commit suicide and they have lower rates of depression. They are also at lower risk of experiencing domestic violence or being the victims of crime. The Harvard sociologist Carl Zimmerman, in his masterwork Family and Civilization, described childbearing as the main stem of the family. Only a man and a woman can bear children. And for as long as childbearing continues, the nuclear family will continue to bury its undertakers. When you look at this picture, what do you see? A woman imprisoned or a woman provided for and protected?